give our thanks. We give our thanks for your peace. We give our thanks for your hope. We give our thanks for your grace. In this worship, dear Lord, come to us and help us to let go of all things that keep us in darkness. Often in our days, we sit in our darkness and cry and complain about the dire circumstances that have overtaken us. We fall short in darkness, not daring to believe that healing and life are only prayer away. And the darkness of our souls invades all of our lives. It colors our attitude, determines our actions. It lets us down and makes us doubt that you are God possible. Lord, we pray, Prince of Peace and God of Love, come and shine your light upon us. Shine your light not just upon us, but in us and through us. As your children of light, break the barriers we have erected against peace. Freestyle us in the light of love, and let us shine in the reflection of your peace, hope, and grace. This day we pray for the places where we protect your people. Strengthen and comfort them, and bring them hope. We pray for those who are ill, those who are broken, those who are worried. Bless them abundantly, and restore us, their body, their mind, and their life. We pray for our nation, for the unity, and for the dignity of the people. Please don't mock us with the Holy Spirit, and help us follow your guide. And for us we pray, may we be your people today, as we meet your presence once again in this worship service. For all these things we pray in Jesus' name. And we continue to pray as Jesus taught during the Lord's Prayer, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
you may be seated. So before we move on, let me share with you some of the things that is going on in this church and what's going to happen today and for the weeks to come. First of all, I want us to recognize that we have Highland Support Project in the house. Yes. One of our mission partners, and they are working hard in Guatemala. And I've been talking to some people in Guatemala that is not related to Highland Support Project. They are saying, every time I look at the website, they are saying they are doing amazing work in the community. I'm so proud that we are partners with them, and they are visiting us to share what we are doing together, as well as to share some islands that are made by the Guatemalan people that we love and that we serve. So, may I have you? Both of you, please. Both of you. You guys are together. Please come forward. And we're going to be in a room or five after the worship service. I want you to share what you're doing and how you're doing it right now. Keep on here for you guys.
I'm greeting to you from Guatemala. It's one of the Maya languages is Quichén, and that's one of the communities that we are working. And what I said was basically good morning and thank you for welcoming us today. And I'm so excited and grateful to be here with you because when our support organization came out, my dreams or my dreams to help my community and my people would not be possible. So I Thank you for trusting in our mission, to give voice to those women, to those communities that is needed. I've been working here in the United States since 1994, and I think the community of the Methodist Church, they welcome me and supporting our vision and our mission.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I just wanted to share one thought to kind of grasp what we're about. And that is this Maya saying that insanity isn't the loss of reason, it's the loss of everything else. And if we look at the flag of our denomination, the cross with the flame, that flame represents everything else. And so today you have an opportunity to come back yonder to engage in a sacred act of creating a marketplace that's sacred. In indigenous culture, there's the notion that everything is sacred. And we frequently look at the market with a lot of logic and reason on how to increase efficiency, how to maximize profit. But we lose this ancient notion of the market as actually a sacred web of life that connects us. If I have beans, you have oranges, I need to buy the seed from your oranges, you need the protein from my beans. We are locked together, much like the Methodist Church, there's this word connectionalism. And connectionalism is what allows us, as all individual people scattered across the planet, to develop the kind of power like Uncle right now in Appalachia after hurricanes. And so we seek to engage congregations in thinking about things, about how we can go deeper and transform our world, transform our daily lives and things we do, to look at the world as a sacred place, and to remember it's not just logic and reason, it's love, compassion, and empathy that makes the world a livable place. So, adios.
So that we can continue this partnership. Second of all, let me share with you that there will be something that is also coming up after the worship service, which is the Charge Conference. Charge Conference is the part of the United Methodist Connectionalism. This is church of conference, and this is the grassroots conference of the church. So we make some decisions about the ministry that we elect the leadership, we confirm the budget, there's some things. But we, Old Bridge Church, uses the church calendar that starts in July, so we actually did almost everything important back in spring. This time, for the legal matter, we have to approve the clergy compensation form, which you will have during the church conference. So after the worship, by the way, we're going to finish the worship outside of our sanctuary, so please come back to the sanctuary for just 5 minutes so that we can make everything that we do legal. So that's what we're going to do after the worship service. So please remember that. Election is coming up, and I want to pray throughout all day. So begin at 6 a.m. until 7 p.m. when the poll closes, the voting offices are closing. I want to pray every single moment. So we have made 30 minutes of slots. I'm not asking you to pray for 30 minutes. But during your slot, please remember the election. Please remember the people. Please remember the leaders and those who are working for the election places so that this can go well, peacefully, and with you. So please pray for the nation with us. You can sign up any slot of the day, throughout the day, by going to our church website, oldbridgechurch.org, and you can find exactly the same banner. Click it, and it'll lead you to the sign-up page so that you can choose your sign for your donation with the church and the people that love. Last but not least, let me just share with you about a little bit about refrigerator. While we're doing this move, we discovered we have a lot of things. One of the things that we have to play was inside the refrigerator. And I'm sorry that I've told you this for quite a long time, but what we discovered in the refrigerator is not something that you want to save up for the big time. It was abandoned for a little while, and there were it was more mold than food. So at this juncture, I just leadership have decided that we're going to use the refrigerator as the preparatory purpose, not to keep the leftover. Does that make sense to you? So after any event of the church, please bring the leftover home. There's no one who's going to consume it during the week. We have the preschool, and if they're all meal friends, I have my own meal friends. So you don't have to keep any leftover in the church. Please bring it home and share with your neighbor. But for the refrigerator, we're going to use it for the preparatory purpose. If you have an event coming up, label it, leave it in the refrigerator, and consume it for the day. And please bring it home. So yeah, that's one what I wanted to share. So preparation, yes. Leftover, no. Please do that. That's what we're going to do for the refrigerator as we move forward.
Apply that to the freezer in the pantry as well.
Oh, yes. Yeah, not just the refrigerator. The freezer, the graphic is just showing you the freezer too. So freezer included, absolutely. So please keep that in your mind so that you can be good stewards of our refrigerator as much as
possible.
All right, friends, that's what we're going to do. So as we are preparing our hearts for the message that we're talking about, we're going to talk about presence a little bit. So I want us to be reminded that this presence is not just just for us, but for the presence of the Lord is among us as well. As we prepare our hearts for this message, would you please stand from where you are and sing with us, only the presence of the Lord is in this place. We're going to sing together.
Thank you.
things working hard. At this moment, we're going to read a scripture that is from Psalm 89 and say the scripture here.
Thank you. In the spirit of praise and song, chapter 89, 14 through 28. Can you hear me back?
Yes.
Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Love and faithfulness go before you. Blessed are those who have learned to acclaim you, who walk in the light of your presence. They rejoice in your name all day long. They exult in your righteousness. For you are their glory and strength. And by your favor, you exalt our horn. Indeed, our shield belongs to the Lord, our King, to the Holy One of Israel. Once you spoke in a vision to your faithful people. You said, I have bestowed strength on a warrior. I exalted a young man from among the people. I have found David, my servant. With my sacred oil, I have anointed him. My land will sustain him. Surely my arm will strengthen him. No enemy will subject him to tribute. No wicked man will oppress him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down his adversaries. My faithful love will be with him, and through my name, his horn will be exalted. I will set his hand over the sea, his right hand over the rivers. He will call out to me, you are my Father, my God, the rock, my Savior. I will also appoint him my firstborn, the most exalted of the kings of the earth. I will maintain my love to him forever, and my covenant with him will never.
And this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
During this series, by the way, we are on the worship series as we talk about this true worship. We are United Methodist Church, and when we become a United Methodist member, there are five members of vows that we are making before we become a member. We commit our lives for the life of prayer, presence, gift, service, and witness. We're talking about each gift every single week, and we are on the second week of this series. We're going to talk about praise. And during this series, we want to hear from the people who have been living it out and how the vows have been helping them to grow in our discipleship and their life. So we're going to interview a couple of people this morning who have been here in the sanctuary and present. And these presence, minister presence, have a lot of changing their lives. So Andrea, please come forward. And I think Brianna is going to be the youth interviewee. Please come forward.
It also wasn't unusual for a pastor to
at dinner time, sitting at the dinner table with us every evening. As I grew older, I just continued into the church, and it was a regular practice. I would say it was an expectation in our home when we went to prom. It was, you do know you have to be at church in the morning, so just be done. So it was an expectation. It's a part of my little family culture, but the community culture, you kind of knew which kids were going to which church out in the community as well. And the church was an active part of the community life. As I grew older, the reasons for going to church changed. It went from culture to then as a teen, and then as a young adult, I started taking more ownership of my faith. As a teen, I participated in United Methodist Youth Fellowship, UMYF. I served as an officer there, actually represented Virginia going to the United Nations in 1971 with the contingency up there, was able to experience some local mission projects as well as international mission projects. In college, I worked at the Wesley Foundation for a year, and I also went to regular mission during spring break. So faith became an active and enriching part of my lived experience. And as an adult, there came a change in my faith, especially when I had children, and it became more of a personal relationship with God and with Jesus Christ. And it's that personal relationship that keeps me coming, and also the relationships that I have within the church
family. It looks like you can never grow, Andrea. And by the way, I was born in 1979. it looks like you've been everywhere, and I know that life is busy, not just for the people that are working in full time, but also for the students. I'm a parent of three teenagers, and it's just crazy to see that life how their life is going. It takes planning to be present in the worship or in the church or services or small groups and things like that. How do you prioritize your life? Can you share a little about your wisdom?
I try to prioritize my life by putting God over everything. I believe that if I bring my worries to God, God will guide me in everything else that I do.
By the way, her father is a fan of Manchester City, which makes me a one major hater.
I'd say
most. The place I engage with the most in the church is probably the preschool. I'd say being around the children has definitely changed me. And it's different seeing life through the perspective of a child versus how you see it.
Thank you. That's great. And I hope you know that the change is emotional. You're not just going to change it, but you're changing perhaps as well in a positive way.
Thank you.
That's great. And you, please.
My faith and my life have been greatly enriched by participation in the church. As I mentioned before, it's a way of practicing loving God and loving each other. So I sing in the choir. Singing in choirs in different church communities has grown and developed into a creative act of worship. Participating in Bible study and in Sunday schools, our nurturing communities from a faith walk, participating in Men and Women in Faith, children's ministries, and other missions, carry the message of love from here out into the world, out into the community. Another adjunct going to Guatemala and building stoves, there's another example of doing that. I've also had a safe place to go during times of hardship, and I can't escape how we will forget. Each of us have those dark times that come in our life, and you don't have to walk that alone. You have the supportive living family to help you work through those times and hold you. Maybe you can really walk.
Yeah, there are lots of great things that we can glean from the ministry of presence. But still, life is just boring. You know, sometimes calendar, if you look at the calendar of each other, you're going to be surprised. How many things are we remembering? You know, we're juggling a lot of duties. What advices can you give to those who are struggling with being present in those wonderful opportunities because of the busy life?
I would say if you worry about coming to church or showing up, I would say to give your worries to God and to talk to Him about it, to pray to Him about it. Because for me, being a Christian isn't just a religion, and I feel like it's a one-on-one relationship with God. And your time and showing up and putting effort into your relationship matters.
That's a really good thing. Thank you,
mine's very similar. As with, you know, the same as just growing strong muscles, it takes practice. And if you intend to walk with God and actually practice your Christian faith, then practicing Christian community will be enriching. And it will bless you, and it will bless the community, and it will honor God as you show up and participate. And it may begin with attending Sunday worship in the larger group. But I would encourage everyone to ask God if there might be a small group ministry that needs you. To make that first step, if God gives you that little nudge to just do, you know, maybe do one thing for one small group ministry. I encourage you to act in courage and step out and do that. Make the first step. And as you learn more about loving God and loving others, you'll see that God will light the way forward for you. It won't be a straight line. It never is a straight line. But as you look back over time, you will see a path that has been filled with goodness and with love. And it's an excellent way to experience that in Christian community.
That's great. Can we give a big hand to you? All right, so wild wisdom. You know, sometimes hearing those people who have been here already can tell us a lot about what we are trying to do. And let me just share a little brief message about the scripture, I mean, based on the scripture, as well as the story that we just heard about the presence. So, before we do that, would you pray with me, and for me, let us pray. Lord, Loving and gracious God, we give our thanks to you as we come together, being present in your presence. We ask and we pray that your words may come to us. Help us open our hearts and ears and eyes so that we can see you and hear you and feel your presence. And let us be transformed into the figure that you want us to be, which is better than we are. May the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable and according to your divine will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So last week we started this series. We are taught this based on the scripture, but we also do some group discipleship group card, thinking about and praying about the ways that we can grow in our discipleship vows. Last week we talked about prayer, the first membership vow, and we talked about it and we decided to do some prayers last year. So here's what we got. Just so you know, it is just a part of the prayer plan for the prayer for the upcoming year. We received, as you can see, 60 prayer cards last week with which people shared their plans to pray for minutes ranging between 5 minutes a week to 15 minutes a day. In sum, the whole pledged minutes were 815 minutes a day. Some wrote that they prayed so and so minutes more, meaning that they were actually praying and they're adding more minutes of prayer, but that's the maybe actual number could be greater. That means every day, nearly 14 hours of prayer will be lifted during the day by the friends of Old Bridge. Isn't that amazing? 14 hours of prayer throughout the years. Just think about what kind of changes can be made to our lives, to the world, and to the people. Even though I didn't count them into this grand sum, just in order to avoid some exaggeration, two of the members actually said that they prayed for 24 hours a day, making relationships to God. And this number will continue to grow, I believe. Since these cards will be received throughout the entire series, in addition, at least 22 people said that they plan to join our 9 o'clock prayer movement. If you don't know what it is, we set an alarm at 9 o'clock in the evening. Whenever the alarm means we pray for the people, for the church, and for the world. That's what we do. And 22 more people decided to join this prayer movement. I believe, as we leave out this plan, the upcoming year will be an immeasurable blessing for us and the world around us. As I promised, you will be prayer. You will be in my prayer every day because I'm going to pray for over this heart every day. This is absolutely exciting. And today we think about presence. Probably this is one of the most greatly undervalued covenants among the Christians in our generation. This year, so far, Old Bridge's worth of attendance is averaged about 1:10 every Sunday. It is not a secret, however, that our membership is actually about 800 at this point. 800 members, 110 worship attendance. What do you think about this number difference? One thing that I can clearly tell you is that we are not alone. This is a universal tendency for the churches in the United States. The church's membership attendance ratio is pretty much consistent with what we have right now. Normally, churches in America have a membership that is at least as 3 times as great as their Sunday worship attendance. Back in 2014, I had a chance to listen to one of the peacekeepers in the leadership workshop, and he shared with us at the time that the worship attendance, regular worship attendance, had the definition of regular worship attendance has changed over time. In the past, it was every week of regular attendance was regular attendance to the churches. In 2014, he said, nowadays it is every other week attendance is regular attendance. And in 2020, I had a chance to listen to him again. It was online, of course. And he said, in a changing tone, and now in 2020, it is once every 3 weeks. And 4 years have passed, and I don't know what it is now. I'm afraid to ask. Actually, there are many biblical verses that tell us the importance of worship. Today's scripture is one. Psalm 89 is known as a song of praises because this is about the worship. And this psalmist is praising God in time of suffering, as it says. Happy are the people who know the fast of shout, who walk forward in the light of your confidence. What I love about this phrase is that this psalmist is talking about both knowing God and walking in the face of God, which in other words is being with God. Knowing and being together. The word happy is easily transferred into blessed in other parts of the Bible, and thus the scripture is saying to us, blessed are those who know God and those who are there to encounter God's presence. This is basically what the scripture is telling us. Friends, the world we live today is more complex than it was any other time before. People date online. We shop on the computer. Churches also happen on the go, and COVID made this tendency much faster. So people worship on the web browser, and they worship on their phones. I mean, that's great. The improvement of technology has expanded the concept of church, and now people can connect with those who are not physically there at the moment. I believe also that worship has to happen every place. It's not just for the sanctuary. Every moment and every space in our lives must be a worship, and thus we can worship God without coming to a space of house of worship. Nevertheless, such a reality still cannot undermine the importance of the gift of presence. Of course, we know where God is. God is everywhere. God is inside of us and God is outside of us. God is on the street and God is in the schools. God is in the houses as much as God is in the sanctuary. Therefore, God can meet us everywhere. But there is one biblical truth for us to remember. Friends, God loves us and God cares about us. Therefore, God came to meet us. You know, when we care about something, we go there. Even if we can watch Taylor Swift on YouTube, we go out to listen to her at the concert. Even if the sports channels can provide a better angle for the game, you know, games we love, and the pictures can give us a much greater bird's eye view of the Grand Canyon, we still want to go there and see it through our own eyes. When we love something, we want to go and see it. That's the same for God. God loves us. And therefore, God values physical encounters with us. Let's think about it in this way. If physical encounter was not important to God, why on earth did God come to us in Jesus? If forgiveness was the only one and only purpose for Jesus, God could just sit in the heavenly throne and forgive you. That's enough, right? If the forgiveness is what was the only reason, that could be enough. God's presence among people only ended up in a tragedy on the cross. But the Word, the Bible says, became flesh because God is love, says the Bible. So that people can hear the voice of God in person. So that the people of God can touch the divinity in person. So that people can look into the eyes of God face to face. What an amazing grace. God comes to us, and it is not because God cannot meet us from a distance. God comes to us because God values actual encounters. God wants to meet us, so God comes to us in Jesus and in the Holy Spirit. When I was a child, my mom asked this question to me pretty a lot of times. She asked, "Counselor, where are you? Where are you?" You know, I was a kind of child with a lot of things going on in my mind. When I began to ponder about something, my mind easily slipped out of my mind, and I was not in the reality. I easily lost my attention to the things around me and about everything else than what I was thinking about. Even though I was with my mom, she could recognize that I was not really there with her. So she had to ask me, Kamsa, where are you? Meaning, are you really with me? Interestingly, in the Bible, we hear the same question from God. It was when Adam and Eve committed the first misbehavior, and they were hiding from God in the bushes. God was walking into the garden at that time, and God asked them, where are you? Where are you? Do you think that God doesn't really know where they are? God knows everything. God asked this not because God could not find them, but because I believe God wanted them to come to God for forgiveness at that particular moment. It was not just one time event. Adam and Eve were not the only people who were asked this question. Whenever God called the prophets in the Bible, God called their names and asked them to be present in front of God. And whenever God called their names, the sages of the Bible answered by saying this one word, here I am. This is a sentence in English, but in Hebrew, this is one word, which is hidden. This one word. Many great ancestors of faith said this word in the face of God. Abraham did. Jacob did. Moses did. Hannah, the mother of Samuel, did. And Samuel, following his mother's example, Samuel did the same, said the same word. David, Elijah, Jeremiah, Isaiah, Amos said this. And Ananias said this too, who prayed for Paul, who became later the greatest missionary in history. And today, wanting to be with us and for us to come to God, God is asking us, Amy, where are you? Andrea, where are you? Cornelia, where are you? Friends, presence is our gift to God. God wants to be with us. If you can hear the call, would you say this to me? God.
God, here I am.
Today we are offering another discipleship card. I think the pastors can help you to type the card. We will be offering a discipleship card, and it is for our second discipleship vow, which is presence. Stewardship is about an intentional gift to God, giving of all kinds. And so, I'd like to invite us to a consideration of the giving of our presence for the year to come. Here's how we do this. In a month, how many weeks can we plan to be present in our worship service? It doesn't necessarily have to be an overage. There are moments that you have to be out of time as well. But unless illness or travel prevents you, how many weeks will you intentionally give your time in meeting God in person if possible, or online? Think about the number you can plan and actually practice and write down the number on the form. And you may want to plan to join a small group play or a Bible study for the upcoming year as a way to be present and grow in your relationship to God. I invite you prayerfully to discern your plan. When you are done with the part, almost ready, hold it in your hand, and while we sing the last hymn of the worship, I will be inviting you to bring it to the front and leave it in the last hymn. I invite you to prayerfully make a plan of it, and this is our divine moment. And most of all, I invite you to leave the plan. Until I prompt the word of prayer, please think about your plan for the coming year and write down another dedication.
Thank you.
want you to remember this. We're going to see all the verses in your I Am, Lord, saying that your I Am is the first line. But for the end of the song, as we see the last refrain, we'll be coming out of sanctuary and gather in the north, which is on the first meeting. And Kathy will lead us to lead the marching. So please follow this meeting.
Thank you. coming out. First of all, let me admit it. I'm gonna, as you can tell, I'm gonna just paint something, but I'm not really the best person to do this job. I'm not a painter. I'm nothing handy. But you know, I'm just pastor, so I'm gonna do it. But I want to give a shout out to the person who did a wonderful job. Excuse me. For repainting the yellow stuff in the front. Did you recognize it? Do you recognize this pipe?
Yes.
This was not here before the construction. You know that? It was not. When the contractors took down the ceiling, they discovered that this sprinkler, which is supposed to be here, according to the blueprint, was not there. And then they had to build it, but they could not get into the ceiling because of the hardwood and because of the structure, they could not get in there. So they had to make it outside of the ceiling, which is not the best view, I understand. This is not my best place after the construction. However, I want us to remember, my friend, we always thought that this is here, but it was not there. Is there something that is in your life, something like this? You always take it for granted. You always think that it is always there, but it's not there. It could be your prayer. It could be your presence. It could be your gift, service, or witness. So I invite my friends, every time you see this pipe, when it gets on your nerve, remember, there may be something that you are missing in your life. So I actually asked the contractors not to paint it completely so that we can finish it our own. So I'm going to paint it today to complete this construction. I told you I'm not the best painter. You can see the flaw in this painting. Please forgive me and remember that this may be our story. I told you. Whenever you see this flaw in our construction, remember that we could get this to be our story. Friends, remember who you are. You are the beloved of God. You are here present in the presence of God, praying, serving, praising, worshiping, and doing all good things. Continue to do that, my friends. In the presence of God, remember that you are beloved. Go with the grace of the Creator God, who is creating us anew every day. With the love of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. With the power of the Holy Spirit, that is giving us the gentle nudge every single day to live a life that is according to the will of God. Go in peace and grace, my friends. Remember, you are the disciples of Jesus Christ. Let us go and make this world better. Amen.
Amen.
Now we can go back into the sanctuary for the charge conference and begin to unify for the highest of all projects.
Charge conference.